Hey, I'm Carrie. Welcome back to my channel, or welcome for the first time. All around, welcome. I'm Carrieblogger, a career freelancer on Fiverr.com, where I've been selling as a Fiverr Pro verified copywriter for about the past 8 years. And in today's Freelance Friday video, I am so excited to share a conversation that I had with AllieMadison12. She is another longtime, very successful seller on Fiverr, and she is specifically in the video and spokesperson category. So in today's chat, we are talking a bit about how the platform has changed, steps that she has taken to increase productivity and sustainability for her business moving forward, how we deal with things like revisions and client expectations, all good stuff like that. We're so excited to have you listen in to this little chat, and I hope you really enjoy it. Please be sure to like and subscribe to my channel if you're interested and like this kind of content. I post every single Tuesday and Friday, so you can check in for more freelance advice coming soon. This was my very first attempt at trying to record an interview on Zoom, so serious apologies for how terrible the sound quality is. I'm trying, guys, but what we've said is good, and hopefully you can look past it. Thanks.
So yeah, it's actually super funny that we're actually like meeting up now, because I've seen your work for years and years. Like, literally so many clients have hired me to do stuff for them, and I look at their website and it's like, oh, there's Allie. She's like literally everywhere. Can you like share your how you found it, how you got into it story?
Absolutely. So growing up, I was always very entrepreneurial. I was 18 years old. I had just graduated high school, and I was working as a lifeguard, which paid $7.25. I had also made YouTube videos throughout high school, so I was used to putting together videos. I was making fashion and makeup tutorials at the time, and I was not good at it, but it was fun, and I really enjoyed it. So I searched online for ways to make money, and I came across Fiverr, and at the time it was a different world. And there were also buyer requests on the homepage, and one of the requests was for $5. They were looking for somebody to make a video about what they're interested in. And to this day, I have no idea what the video was for. But I applied to their request because I thought, that's easy. I could make a video for $5 talking about what I'm interested in. There was no script or anything. So they hired me, and I actually created an entire gig just for this one project because I didn't know how Fiverr worked. And so my gig was titled, for $5, I will make a video talking about what I'm interested in.
Is that what it still is today?
Well, the hyperlink, if you look at for one of my spokesperson gigs, that's the hyperlink. And I obviously changed the name when I realized that you don't have to set up an entire gig just for one project.
So many of them had just the dumbest hyperlinks because I didn't realize when I first made it that that was going to stick forever.
I wish we could change it, but at the same time, there's probably so much history with those links, and so it would be complicated. But it just kind of spiraled from there. And then I spent the entire summer before college making videos all the time. And I was able to quit my lifeguarding job because from one or two videos, I was making way more than I would have with lifeguarding.
And the homepage thing was how I got my start, basically. Like, being on the homepage, having literally 100% of Fiverr's traffic see your face, like, that was such a crazy opportunity at the time that I'm really grateful that that happened back then.
Yes. What year did you start?
I started at the end of 2013. So you were like a whole year ahead of me.
Okay. I was 2012, but we got in at a good time.
So then, like, looking at how Fiverr has panned out for you, do you think that that like matched your expectations, or like what initially was your goal to like get out of it?
Starting out, I was just absolutely thrilled to be making more money than I would have lifeguarding. And I was just looking for something to support the lifestyle that I wanted for myself. And ultimately, I am living my dream life. I'm living out everything that I ever wanted. And so absolutely has exceeded expectations. At the time, I didn't know what I wanted to do with my life. When you're 18, that's kind of when you're starting to consider the options. And I went into college undecided. I've always loved making videos, but I was honestly embarrassed to go to college as a comm major. College did not get me to where I am in life. I think I would have had the same outcome no matter what, because I'm an entrepreneur. It was a good experience and I'm grateful for that, but it didn't really change the course of my life or anything. Although I did meet my husband in college, so I am glad that I went for that reason.
It just took me so long to like see the Fiverr train as like a legit career this is something I can do forever. Like it can be so much more than just a side hustle thing. How long do you think it took you to break out of like the original $5 pricing structure and like get into something that was really earning you, you know, more than lifeguard money?
I was offering $5 gigs until maybe 2017, I want to say. So maybe about 3 years ago, but that was just a base. And so usually, even though I offered $5 as a base, usually clients were ordering higher projects. So for anyone who's watching this, who isn't familiar with Fiverr a couple of years ago, it used to just be $5 base, and then you could add on from there. Now there's a package system. And so you can offer different packages.
It was like an algorithm thing that if you didn't have all three package tiers set up, you like didn't show up as well in search.
Exactly. So we were kind of forced into it, which was good. There's a lot of things that Fiverr will implement that at first bother me and I get nervous about, but then I realize they're actually for the better. Like when they track our metrics with how fast you reply, are you delivering on time? All of those metrics used to really stress me out at first, but now I realize they're great because they incentivize you to run a great business and you make more money, Fiverr makes more money. It's a win-win. So I'm actually glad that they implement stuff like that. And it's absolutely scary at first. You're probably worried when you don't have $5 gigs, are people still going to click on your gig?
Exactly.
And in fact, I found that it brings a better type of client when you don't offer $5 gigs. And so your competitor might still be $5 to this day, but the quality clients are going to click on your gig instead.
I've only noticed a positive shift as I've raised my prices with the kind of client that I get to work with. And not even just like, you know, the kind of client, like the relationship, but the projects are more interesting, more nuanced. Like it's been definitely a positive shift as I scale pricing up as well. How did you like learn the skills that you use today and like adding new services and stuff like that? How do you teach yourself?
It's a lot of trial and error. And also I pay attention to client complaints and client requests years ago, I guess 8 years ago at this point. So at the time, clients would say to me, you should have better sound, you should have better lighting, you should have better quality footage. And so over time, I started upgrading everything until now I'm at the point where I very rarely get any sort of complaint about the production, at least. I never get noise complaints, never get lighting complaints. So, and then another thing is, videos are very focused on trends. I'll get a lot of requests lately for selfie style videos. People want natural videos instead of professionally produced, for example. And when I see this trend increasing, I decided to create a gig. And so it's things like that. What are people requesting? What do they want? And then I go from there. Sometimes clients will reach out to me and they want a different type of video that I've never made before, but I say yes to almost everything if I know it's possible because we learn.
Like all of the things I offer now, almost all are things that people have asked for. I tried, I liked, and I've just like gotten better at. It's really important to listen not only to the client requests, but the complaints, like you said, is like such a important point of feedback. And I know that I have a hard time taking that feedback sometimes because it can be like really personal. And especially when I feel like I've just put so much into it, you must have killer social skills if you can look through that and like get to the heart of like how to improve.
No, no, I take it really personally and I get really upset about it. But over time when I get the same complaint a few times, then I realize, okay, it's not you, it's me, but it's still hard. And I still really struggle with that.
One of the hardest things because it's just all like
so
your
hard.
Heart and soul put into it.
Something creative. And so what makes one client happy can make another client upset. I always tell clients, watch all my videos, watch all my samples, and we won't have any issues as long as you watch my videos or in your case, read your previous work. And if they like that, then they'll be fine. But maybe they want a different style and that's okay too. I'm always referring people to other sellers if they have a different vision.
How do you deal with revisions in the video space?
So I have a pretty steadfast revision policy that has been trial and error, and it's taken 8 years to create. I still struggle with it. There's no right answer. Ultimately, I want my clients to be happy. It's more important to me to build long-lasting relationships than to upset somebody once and never work with them again. But at the same time, both parties have to be reasonable, and it's very difficult to have to reshoot a whole video for something that wasn't my fault.
Are you sure? Because we just went through this. It's hard.
So what do? Do you usually cancel or do you work with people until they're happy, even if it's unreasonable?
I try never to cancel because I feel like that's the ultimate like disservice to me to have like done it and then to just throw it all away. Like I would rather go through revisions and ideally charge them for fair work of modifying it and like working it out literally. But I haven't canceled an order probably for 4 years that wasn't just like right out of the gate. That's not something I offer.
That's why you're a pro.
I feel like you can be kind and firm at the same time and like have respect.
Yes, absolutely. It's interesting speaking with different sellers because a lot of my spokesperson colleagues are so quick to cancel. I'm like you, I don't want to cancel anything if I've put work into it. But every once in a while, I know either I'm getting a bad review or I'm going to have to put hours more work into this or things like that. And so I'll cancel every once in a while. Some sellers, some great sellers top rated, they'll cancel immediately if the client's not happy. So it's interesting hearing everybody's mm-hmm. perspective, but I don't think it's good for analytics to have too many cancellations.
So what do you think has been the most helpful or best feature that Fiverr has launched over the years? Because I know we talked about it's just changed so much since we started. And like, what is the one thing that you're like, oh, thank God they finally launched this feature. I can finally use it.
Packages are really nice. Packages are a game changer that allows you to upsell your services and offer a whole package deal. A lot of people don't know what they want, but they can look over the packages and see that it aligns with their budget. And then that's it. Definitely the fast delivery add-on that wasn't always an option. You could offer it in your own gig extras, but it didn't have the whole countdown. So that was a really great change.
The quick responses, I literally had an app on my phone and I was copying and pasting in and I actually got robo flagged and they thought I was spamming people because I kept like copying messages and they're like, what are you copying messages for? And I said, because I need to have these saved responses. And they're like, we are writing that down. We are giving it to the team in charge of whatever. And then like 2 months later, it got released on the platform. I was like, I got us quick responses.
Good one. Oh, well, thank you. That was a big game changer. And I did the same exact thing. And I also got flagged for spam multiple mm-hmm. times. And I would always have to message them. I'm not spamming. I'm not reaching out to anyone who doesn't reach out to me first.
Exactly.
The same thing, copy paste.
How much do you outsource and like how much can you really rely on other people to get things done for you that's actually going to be, you know, helpful and intuitive?
One of the hardest things in running a business is finding quality people to work for you. It's so hard to find people. And so when you find someone good, stick with them. It's been a game changer. I have a few editors that I work with on different skill levels and different types of projects. And we all have each other on Skype and I can just shoot them a quick message and they're reliable and we do the same thing every day. And so they know exactly what to do. So that's really stepped up my game because I'm not a great editor on my own. I need to outsource that. I'm a good spokesperson. That's what I like to do. I like to run my business. I like messaging people. I don't like editing. So I outsource that. I used to do everything myself and the quality just wasn't as good. And now the quality is a lot better and I can charge more as a result.
And then do you work every day of the week? Do you feel like you have weekends? How do you frame your time?
I'm a workaholic. So there are very few boundaries. I'm messaging people if I'm awake at 1 a.m., I'm messaging people at 1 a.m. I'm working all the time. I'm working on the weekend, working nights, mornings, as I want. I can easily take a day off also. I don't have kids, so it's not like I have a lot of commitments. I just have a cat and a dog. And so at this point in my life, I'm just really focused on work and I love what I do. So I'm doing it all the time.
Yeah. I think we're pretty much in the same boat, same thing.
Yeah. Especially with writing, it must be nice to be able to go wherever you want and bring work with you mm-hmm. entirely.
Yeah. I just wish that actually happened more like people say it does. I don't work by the beach every day and I don't go on vacation all the time, but I would like to, I guess, if I actually did.
Also, I think we have the gift of working with so many entrepreneurs and I think entrepreneurs just make our world go round. Even industries that are not doing very well right now are figuring out ways to pivot and serve the world. And it's really, we're so lucky to get to work with these people.
Yeah, just like the visionaries that I get to collaborate with and just like the really cool, exciting new ideas. The things that make me excited to write about it, because I'm like, this is going to be such a good thing when it gets launched.
Yes, it's really great. Hopefully in a couple of years, we'll be at a point where we're running these massively successful businesses and have other people doing the hard work, and then we could stress a little less.
Do whatever the boss man does on the beach, right?
There we go. I don't know what I would do with myself without work, though.
I know. I like my work. Like, I've built something that I enjoy doing genuinely every day. So the idea of giving it up entirely seems like not the right play. I'm curious what kind of gigs you've had over the years besides the ones that have stuck with script writing and spokespeople. Like, what other things have you just tried for fun?
It's embarrassing. When I was 18 and Fiverr was a different world, people were offering literally any type of service. Do a prank phone call. I offered a gig where I would post to people's Facebook. Some guys wanted me to pretend to be their girlfriend, which it's so embarrassing looking back. I don't know why I did that, but it was funny. I offered some video gigs wearing costumes, things like that. Just so embarrassing.
I enjoy that the platform is getting so much more professional and like business oriented, but back then the like just for fun category was huge.
Absolutely. That was the majority of the site. I think it wasn't very professional. It was fun services like that.
I'll share my embarrassing story too, because you just did. A guy was doing a YouTube channel and he wanted it to be like retro Nickelodeon, basically. And so those old like slime videos where people get slime poured on them. And so he was like trying to recreate that. And so he paid me for like four different videos of getting slime poured over my head. And that's like, phone, did you do it too?
The same thing.
Oh my gosh. My mom has them. She like shares them like every 3 years on Facebook. And I'm like, so embarrassing.
So funny. What if we get famous and those videos are just going to come out? But you know what? At the time, I charged him so much money. I think
me too. It was like the most I charged for anything. Well, it was fantastic talking with you. Thank you so much for giving up your time. And I'm just always fascinated to talk to longtime people building legitimate businesses. It's just so fascinating to hear your story and your side of things. So thank you.
Yeah, it was so nice meeting you.
Thank you so much again, Allie, so much for taking the time to chat with me and share your experience on Fiverr. If you are interested in spokesperson videos, I highly recommend you go check her out. Again, she is AllieMadison12 on the Fiverr platform. And then if you haven't yet, be sure to like and subscribe. You're going to help me out a lot, and I just love having you here with me. So thank you. All right, let's get back to work.